Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Can't Stop Thinking, How to Let Go of Anxiety and Free Yourself from Obsessive Rumination, by Nancy Colier. Foreword by Stephen Bodian. Narrated by Kitty Hendrix. Publisher's Note. This publication is designed to provide accurate and authoritative information in regard to the subject matter covered. It is sold with the understanding that the publisher is not engaged in rendering psychological, financial, legal, or other professional services. If expert assistance or counseling is needed, the services of a competent professional should be sought. Foreword. I can still remember the day I realized that my thinking was driving me crazy. As an aspiring academic in college, I believed in the value of the mind to create realms of complex thought that could solve all humanity's problems. But in my own life, I had no control over my own thoughts, and I found myself obsessing about a new relationship to the point that I was so anxious I could barely eat or sleep. Did she or didn't she? Would she or wouldn't she? The doubts and negative scenarios my mind churned out had sucked all the joy out of life. So I finally did what I had contemplated doing for years, since I had begun studying the spiritual traditions of the East as a freshman. I took a subway downtown to a traditional Zen center and embarked on the practice of meditation. Little did I suspect at the time that this was the beginning of a lifelong dedication to the spiritual life, and to discovering how we can free ourselves from suffering and live happy, peaceful, awakened lives. It took me years of following my breath and watching my thoughts as a good Zen student to gradually gain a little distance from the obsessive ruminating that plagued me. In those days, there were no shortcuts. No readily available guidebooks on the nature of the mind. No one to say simply, "Look, snap out of it. You're not your thoughts." In other words, no books like this one. For Can't Stop Thinking distills a lifetime of wisdom gleaned from the author's own meditation experience, her teaching of others, and her decades of counseling clients on working with the mind, into a concise how-to manual for disidentifying from your thoughts and finding peace and contentment in the present moment without years of meditation. As Collier suggests, we're addicted to our thinking, and we believe we can't enjoy life without identifying with the endless stories the mind churns out. Indeed, we take this complex narrative to be who we really are, the truth of our being as a separate self, and we're afraid of what life might be like without it. Sure, we may be suffering mightily, but we firmly believe that the suffering is an inevitable result of what's happening outside of us, what others are doing to us, what life is imposing upon us, rather than seeing it as optional and within our power to regulate. We may even have an allegiance to our suffering because we believe we need to atone for the mistakes we've made, shoulder the legacy of family pain, and learn the lesson it's trying to teach us. Collier invites us to kick this addiction and forswear this allegiance by taking a single radical step in a new direction. Instead of blaming circumstances out there, over which, after all, we have very little control, we can turn the finger back upon ourselves and realize that the source of our suffering lies within, in the judgments we make, the stories we perpetuate, the interpretations we project. Life is the way it is, not always pleasing or painless, but we can choose how we respond to it. And the most radical, freeing step of all is to recognize that you are not the content of your thoughts. You are the awareness in which these thoughts arise and pass away. This realization is the first step on the path of awakening from the dream of separation, what the spiritual traditions call enlightenment. For the past 40 years, I've been guiding seekers on the journey of awakening, and this first step is always the most powerful and life-transforming. You are not your thoughts. What an extraordinary insight. When you see this once and for all, you've opened a doorway to a whole new way of being, one that offers the promise of peace, happiness, and fulfillment that can't be shaken by the ups and downs of life. Can't Stop Thinking leads you by the hand through this door and beyond. Stephen Bodian, licensed psychotherapist, spiritual teacher, founder and director of the School for Awakening, and author of Meditation for Dummies, Wake Up Now, and Beyond Mindfulness. Introduction. Addicted to Thinking. It was a magnificent spring morning, and I was walking in the park near my home. Well, that's not really true. I was walking, yes, but not exactly in the park. I was oblivious to the colorful flowers blooming, the warm sunshine, the smell of cut grass. I was missing all of it, having disappeared inside my own head, into my personal prison, thinking. No matter how delicious that May day may have been, I wasn't experiencing it. I was trapped inside my mind, obsessing about what was not working in my life, replaying and rethinking the same problems I'd been replaying and rethinking for years. I was down the rabbit hole of thought. And then something remarkable happened. My inner lens spun on its axis. Instead of being inside my thoughts, I was now the one looking at and listening to my thoughts. I was now the one the thoughts were talking to. I could see in the brightest technicolor what I was choosing to pay attention to. I was suddenly watching my attention attached to this toxic content, watching it latch onto and lather up my discontent. I felt the insidiousness of my thoughts and a kind of bewilderment and horror at my own inclination toward them. I experienced my thinking as something I was actually doing to myself. In that moment, I could see that I was the one replaying the same stories of discontent, conducting the same resentful conversations in my head with the same results. Suffering. My suffering. At last, I could really hear my thoughts, distinctly, and recognize how bad they made me feel. I observed my negative thoughts for what they were, a kind of self-administered poison. Then the aha moment arrived. It dawned on me that I could do this differently, this whole life thing. I could change what I was paying attention to, turn away from the source of my suffering. Not just intellectually, but at a deep bodily level, I knew that I was creating my experience, and therefore I had the power to change it. If I was willing to transform the way I related to my thoughts, I could create a radically different kind of life for myself. Simultaneously, it became clear that no amount of thinking and none of my brilliant thoughts were actually going to solve the problem I was ruminating on. My thinking mind had met its match. I couldn't solve this particular problem, not with more thought, anyway. Whatever I wanted to get, wherever I wanted to get to, if it was going to happen, it was not going to happen through more thinking. I got it. Thinking was not going to bring me the happiness or peace I had hoped it would. That moment arrived after a lifetime of narrating, analyzing, and making sense of my own and everyone else's experience, all to an audience of one, me. Ruminating on what was bothering me, obsessing about how to fix it, and describing my experience to myself over and over again. It came after years spent constructing sophisticated mental narratives on why what was happening in my life was happening and what I needed to do to change it. The clarity came after far too much time spent justifying and defending why I was right and right to have the experience I was having, defending all this in the court of my mind. The awakening I experienced came after a lifetime of, essentially, fighting with and trying to control reality inside my own head. On that day in the park, I discovered a new lens through which to see my life, and with it, a new identity. I had not previously known any way to experience life other than through my thoughts, as the thinker. There was no witness, no me, other than the one who was thinking. I was collapsed into the thoughts appearing in my mind. Like most people, too, I had spent my life trusting that I could think my way into a state of happiness and inner peace, that more and better thinking was the solution to all the difficulties life presented. I had believed that if I worked hard enough, muscled my way through enough mental gymnastics, I could figure out whatever was not right with my world. And once I figured it out, I could fix it. Normal, but not okay. For more than 25 years as a psychotherapist, I've been listening to people talk about their lives. Every kind of problem, situation, history, and personality has walked through my office door. While the contents of our problems and situations may appear in different forms and levels of intensity, there's really one universal problem at the root of all other problems. At the core, our stress, anxiety, and chronic discontent are caused by one thing, the way we relate to our thoughts. It's our relationship with thought that makes us suffer. Jane is in a bad marriage. She spends her days and nights, and sessions with me, thinking about what's wrong with her husband and why he's so unlikable. Obsessively, she explains the reasons for her anger, the justifications for why she's right to feel how she feels. She explains all this to herself and anyone who will listen. When she's not ruminating on her resentment, Jane is obsessing on her own faults, blaming herself for staying in a bad marriage, for not being the feminist who would leave. She is trapped inside a repetitive, negative thought loop. She goes to work, takes care of her family, and looks healthy on the outside, like someone living a good life. She has moments of joy. On the inside, however, she feels anxious, agitated, and held hostage by her own thoughts. Allison is a new mother who's just returned to work from maternity leave. Every moment she's away from her son, she thinks about the thousands of terrible things that could happen to her child. Terrorist attacks, SIDS, choking on a Cheerio, and on and on. Sometimes she calls me in the middle of the day when her thoughts turn to panic. When her mind is not generating death scenarios, she shifts to thinking about the devastation she will feel when the terrible thing happens, how she won't be able to survive it. When she manages to pull her attention away from this imagined horror, she thinks about how despicable she is as an absent mom, about how angry she is at her husband for not making enough money to let her stay home with her child, and endless other resentful thoughts. She thinks excessively and obsessively about the very things that torture and terrify her. Finally, let's consider Ken, who believed he was going to become president of the company he worked for. Unexpectedly, he was let go and has been out of work for nearly a year. Since his removal, Ken has been incessantly thinking about what he did wrong that got him fired, replaying the possible missteps he took along the way, down to the photographs he kept on his desk. He asks me every week why I think he got fired. When he's not ruminating on his professional mistakes, he's thinking about his personal failures, and specifically, how ridiculous and deluded he was for imagining he could be somebody important. Ken's thoughts, like many people's thoughts, remind him, day after day, of what he isn't. While these individuals may sound like extreme examples of excessive thinking or what we sometimes call overthinking. They're actually quite typical of the reality many people live on a daily basis. Excessively and relentlessly is how we think. Most of us are not thinking about unicorns or rainbows either. We're thinking about the things that make us feel the worst. We feel compelled to think about what hurts, and so we suffer. If you can't stop thinking even when you want to, you're not alone. Like any other addiction. It may sound ridiculous, disrespectful, or absurd to compare the process of thinking, something so utterly natural, productive, and important, to something so dangerous, destructive, and out of control as addiction. A friend, upon hearing the topic of this book, raised her voice to say, "Thinking is not like shooting drugs or drinking. Human beings think. That's what we do." Thinking is inarguably useful, necessary, creative, and miraculous. It's what distinguishes human beings from other species. The ability to think is a good thing. Thinking is the source of invention, imagination, problem-solving, and organization, to say nothing of putting together a grocery shopping list. So, I am not suggesting that we give up thinking. We couldn't even if we wanted to. This is not an anti-thinking book, or a how-to on living a lobotomized life. In fact, I'm delighted to be thinking right now as I write these words. Thinking itself, this natural ability of the mind, is not what causes us to suffer. Thoughts themselves are not inherently problematic. What's problematic is our belief that thoughts require being thought about. What causes us to suffer is our identification with thoughts, the belief that we are our thoughts. This is the real issue, and precisely what makes it so difficult for us to disentangle from thoughts and find freedom inside our own mind, our own life. Are you addicted? If you ask most people casually if they are addicted to thinking, they will say yes. But if you ask people whether thinking is an addiction, the same people will balk and deny it. Our response to the question, when we don't think about it too much, when we answer from the gut, is very different than when we pose the question to the mind, whose job, not coincidentally, is to make thoughts. Do you find it hard to stop thinking about certain things, even when you absolutely want to stop thinking about them? Do you feel like your thoughts control your attention and mood? You're probably addicted to thinking, which means you're normal. And yes, you can be addicted to something that's natural and good for you. Can be addicted to an activity that you enjoy and benefit from. Can be addicted to something you can't live without. While your thinking addiction may not cost you your job or land you in rehab, nonetheless, your behavior is similar, with results that are similarly redundant, destructive, and painful. To start, let's consider the aspects of addiction discussed in the American Psychiatric Association's most recent Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders, DSM-5, the Bible of sorts for all things psychological, and apply them to thinking as an addiction. Ask yourself, does thinking sometimes negatively impact my overall well-being? Has thinking created problems in my relationships? Have work or home responsibilities been neglected because of thinking? When I notice that I haven't been thinking, do I experience fear or anxiety or a sudden excess of thinking? Do I find myself thinking more and spending longer stretches of time thinking? Have I tried to cut back on my thinking, but not been able to make it happen? Do I spend a lot of time thinking? Has my thinking led to physical or psychological health problems, anxiety, or depression? Have I cut down on or stopped doing activities I once enjoyed in order to spend more time thinking? Do I ever look forward to or crave thinking? If you are like most people, you answered yes to 6 or 7 of these questions. Every person I've ever interviewed, without exception, has said that their thinking, in one way or another, creates problems in their life and disrupts their overall well-being. Whether it's from too much thinking or the content of what you're thinking about, excessive thinking causes problems in our relationships, work, health, quality of life, and overall well-being. Thinking is like any other addiction, except for the fact that we don't think it's an addiction, and also for the fact that we take breaks between our drink, drug, and food binges, but we don't when it comes to our thinking. We devote ourselves to thinking without pause, from the cradle to the grave. Remarkably, no matter how much we suffer as a result of our thinking, we keep at it with the same resolute faith that thinking will provide the solution to whatever ails us. We continue doing what we've always done, despite inarguable proof that much of our thinking is not productive and actually makes us more anxious, stressed, and unhappy. We keep doing the very thing that harms us, while hoping for and believing in a different result. We do what we've always done and get what we've always gotten. Where, oh, where is the off button? There's no off button, is how many people describe their relationship with addictive thinking. Once we start thinking about a problem or situation, we're unable to pull ourselves away from it. We descend into the rabbit hole, even though we don't want to go in there, even though we're aware that the thinking itself is what's making us unhappy. As Jane lamented, there are times I am literally asking myself, as I am thinking, why am I still thinking about this? I want to stop. Why can't I stop? But I just keep at it. It can be astoundingly difficult to pull our attention away from negative thought loops. We are physically, mentally, and emotionally hooked, intensely resistant to the idea of letting go of the thoughts, no matter how much pain they're creating or how much we hate thinking about them. We are at war with our thoughts and ourselves at the same time. The obsessive thoughts feel dreadful, but if we dare turn our attention away from them, we experience a fierce backlash that can feel almost worse than the thoughts themselves. While strange, it seems as if we, at some level, actually enjoy, benefit from, or feel empowered by the negative thoughts. For sure, we are attached to them and unwilling to let go. Usually, we keep thinking until we're forced to turn our attention to something else that can't wait. A crying child, a burning pot, or until we go unconscious, either through sleep or self-medication, which, sadly, is the solution many people are choosing these days. In order to stop the cacophonous noise in our head, we have to anesthetize our thoughts and ourselves in the process. We use external substances to relieve our addiction to this overpowering substance called thought. And yet, it is apparent that the word addicted is also misused, misunderstood, and thrown around with far too much levity. Addicted has become a trendy way of describing any behavior we think we overdo or even enjoy. I'm addicted to gummy bears. I'm addicted to Netflix. I'm addicted to spin class. There's nothing light or enjoyable about real addiction. I do not use the metaphor of addiction without deep respect for the reality of it. Thinking can indeed lead us down its own path of self-destruction, a destruction we live privately, in the confines of our own mind, and sometimes without the visible or obvious consequences that often lead us to seek help. Who's in charge? We must remember this. When thoughts happen and what they're about are not in our control. The mind produces thoughts like the heart pumps blood, or the pancreas generates insulin. It's what the mind does, its job. Thoughts form in mysterious ways in the recesses of our consciousness and seem to appear out of the ether. They certainly don't ask our permission to enter into awareness. The reality of constant, random, and uninvited intruders appearing in our consciousness would be challenging enough. But when we compound this truth with the fact that we believe we must also engage with and make sense of each of these unvetted intruders, we end up with a much bigger challenge than just randomly appearing thoughts. We end up powerless over our own attention. As long as our attention is bouncing around at the mercy of thoughts we don't choose, we remain passengers rather than pilots in our own life. As long as our attention is out of our control, we're trapped on the thinking train, and our life, essentially, is out of our control. The fun of it. I recently asked an addict what he feared most about giving up his substance of choice, which in this case was alcohol. Without a moment's hesitation, he said that if he stopped using, he would never have fun again, never have sex again, never go out with friends again, never enjoy life. His life would be utterly mediocre, joyless. Indulging, as he viewed it, was the key to excitement and a happening life. The thought of a life with less thinking is similarly perceived as empty or boring. One client described it as life without spice, bland, dull, a void. Another asked, without thinking, why be alive? From inside our thinking addiction, we can't imagine what could make life interesting without our stories and drama, all the yummy byproducts of our thoughts. When I told people I was writing a book about our universally shared addiction to thinking, I was frequently met with a sense of outrage. That's ridiculous. How would we get anything done if we weren't thinking? Nothing is possible without thinking. Or, as one friend retorted, so then I should face a blank wall and hum om for the rest of my life? Life is short. I want to be in it. Their reactions imply that, without our perpetual thinking, we will be left in some sort of vegetative state, unable to take action or do anything. It is as if the very possibility of life occurring depends upon our thinking. Exploring this topic has shown me how provocative and unwelcome the idea of doubting the veracity of our thoughts, of disidentifying with them, really is in our society. Contemplating the act of thinking as something we do, not as something we are, appears to be deeply threatening to us. Not thinking suggests a kind of death. Given the complexity of what thinking represents, we ferociously protect our relationship with it. To that end, most of us employ a sophisticated array of beliefs about why we should never and will never give up our love affair with thought, even when evidence suggests our thinking is hurting us. In truth, however, we are not to blame for our relationship with thoughts. We relate to thoughts the way we've been taught to relate to thoughts, as profoundly important bits of wisdom that deserve and demand our rapt attention. We kneel at the feet of all our thoughts as if they contain the answers to all our questions. Recovery. Why are there so many books written on the topic of thinking, negative thinking, overthinking, binge thinking, and all the other kinds of thinking that create stress and unhappiness and leave us feeling powerless? Why do the theories and solutions to our thinking addiction keep coming? And furthermore, why is thinking still such an epidemic problem? Most of us believe that if we could only change our bad thoughts to good ones, write enough gratitude lists, repeat enough affirmations, then we would be happy. Most of us think it's our fault that our mind overwhelms us so much. We must not be doing the right work or enough of it. But the truth is, It's not our fault. We don't recover from our addiction to thinking through the strategies most self-help literature advises. We don't have to like our thoughts to be free. Self-help is solving the wrong problem. Recovery from excessive thinking is not about stopping thoughts or achieving a thought-free existence. At the same time, it's not about changing what our thoughts are about, skewing our thoughts from negative to positive. Although this can be helpful, it's not the solution. Recovery happens when we change the way we interact with thoughts, the value we assign them, the belief we invest in them, and the attachment we have to them, no matter what contents or messages they contain. We recover when our allegiance shifts from being aligned with the thoughts and their content to being aligned with the one who the thoughts are talking to, or at, which is what you'll be learning more about in the sections to come. This book is here to help you build a safe shore, a refuge inside yourself, from which to see and interact with the thoughts appearing in your consciousness. My hope is that with this new awareness, you will be able to cultivate a more conscious and intentional relationship with thoughts. All this so that you can be content regardless of what the out-of-order computer in your head is spitting out at any given moment. This book is designed to show you how to break free from the compulsion to turn every thought into an occasion for thinking, to stop worshiping at the altar of your mind. My goal is not to help you find freedom from thought, but rather to find freedom with thought. Thoughts are not going away. They're not going to go away. We wouldn't want them to anyway. My purpose here is to illustrate a way to be free and autonomous while your thoughts are firing, and most of all, to shepherd you into the well-being and peace that is inside you, and always there. Below the thoughts and thinking. Breaking your addiction to thinking requires falling out of love with the endless material your mind generates without your consent. This process involves a willingness to recognize what your excessive thinking is actually doing to you, the suffering you are creating for yourself, and how your thinking choices, or lack thereof, are impacting the quality of your life. The good news is that your thoughts don't need to change one iota for you to be released from them, or rather, to release yourself from them. A good life. While we have a sophisticated educational system, oddly, we don't learn the most important skill we need to maintain a basic state of well-being. In order to create and sustain a good life, we must cultivate a conscious and constructive relationship with our own thoughts, a relationship that allows us to use thinking for the delicious benefits it offers, but that doesn't permit thinking to take over our life or wreak havoc on our experience. We have infinitely more choice than we know when it comes to our attention and what we do with it. We are not powerless when it comes to what thoughts we take a ride on. We don't have to live at the mercy of the thoughts our mind throws at us, which is positively not what our mind wants us to think. A glass of wine can be used as a lovely treat at the end of a long day, but that same substance can be used as a means to flee from our life, avoid the present moment, inflict self-harm, fulfill an obsession, or any number of destructive ends. This is true of our thinking as well. When we think without awareness, discernment, and discipline, we give up control of our life. We give away our own attention, and with it, the authority to decide our state of mind and being. Throughout this book, I will lay out the subtle and not so subtle consequences.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.